It's been over 25 years since the Isabella Stewart Gardner Museum heist in Boston, and a brand new book called The Museum Heist is out by author Kameel Nasr, who's coming to the Thomas Crane Public Library Tuesday evening, December 8th, to talk a little bit more about this project and about himself. But he's giving us a little preview right now. So, Kameel, welcome. Thanks for
coming. Oh, thanks. Thanks so much. Really nice to be here.
You have a very interesting background. Tell us a little bit about yourself, if you could.
Well, I was born in Lebanon. I grew up in San Francisco and traveled around the world. I traveled the world by bicycle, and I wrote about that in my first book, The World Up Close. And the last few years, I wanted to talk about the heist at the Isabella Stewart Gardner Museum, because it was such a great loss to our city and to the art world. And it's a crime that hasn't been solved, and we want to know where it's at. So I made up a story. I made up a fictional story. And in fiction, the good thing about it is you can solve the crime. I don't know where we will ever solve the crime, but I solved the crime in a kind of a nice way. And but people want to know about where the investigation is. So I think I'll be talking about that when I'm in the library.
For folks who do remember that, I think it was St. Patrick's Day or the
That's
day
right,
before,
yeah.
1990.
Yeah, 25 years ago,
yeah.
Right.
It still intrigues folks even to this day, because is it still, as to your knowledge, the largest art heist ever in the history of the world?
Right. Yeah. It's right. It's if you had those paintings and you took them to Christie's, you could probably get $500 million for it. There's never been a robbery to that scale.
Mm-hmm.
But equally, you know, those pictures are only worth what the reward money, $5 million, because you can't do anything with them. You can't take them to Christie's. You can't take them to down the street,
right,
to the local gallery.
Right.
So why haven't they been turned back?
Raised, this is the question, right? Why
exactly.
did they take them in the first place?
Yeah. Right, yeah. Why did they take them?
Yeah.
And there are a number of theories about that. Mm. One of the theories is that they were taken to get somebody out of prison.
Mm.
And we could talk a little about that.
Mm-hmm. Interesting.
But in my book, so I just kind of, as I said, I made up this delightful story. It features a police investigator who's kind of a fumbling Columbo type character, but very sharp.
Mm-hmm.
And the person who actually finds the paintings in my story is a classical scholar. So I get to talk about one of my favorite subjects, which is classical Greece, and of course about art.
Hmm, interesting.
Yeah.
Now, are there any facts in the book at all when it comes to this story?
There are. Oh yeah, there are. So, yeah, I don't distort the facts.
Okay.
But then, from the original facts, I make a story out of it.
Okay. So, how did you research this particular work? Did you talk to investigators involved in the case?
Yes, I did talk to investigators. In fact, I was just telling somebody that about 2.5 years ago, one of the lead investigators told me personally, said, "Oh, Kameel, the case is almost solved.
Mm-hmm.
It'll be a matter of months. We're going to go down to Philadelphia and collect the paintings."
Really?
Yeah. It was like almost had it. And the FBI thought that they did have it.
Yeah.
But they were wrong.
What's your particular theory, especially after researching this work?
My theory, not to take the sail out of the wind out of the sail of my talk,
right,
but my theory is that there were a couple of thugs. They didn't have much of a plan.
Mm.
The paintings are they're dead. I think everybody knows that the people who were involved.
Yeah.
There were 3, 4, 5 characters who seemed central to the story. They're dead, and their secret is in the grave.
Really?
So, and there's, you know, there's the paintings are lost, right? If they were, if there was a gang that did it, they would have turned up by now. The paintings are lost. There's a chance, God forbid, there's a chance that they're destroyed.
Mm.
This has happened with other art. There was a a famous museum heist in Rotterdam, and they took a Picasso, a Monet water lily, a Matisse, several paintings that are worth about $50 million, over $50 million. The police rounded up a gang of Romanians, and the mother of one of these people had the art in her house and burned it.
Really?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, so, I mean, it's... Hmm.
So we may never know then.
We may never know.
The fate of these
works. Yeah, yeah, and it's such a tragedy. But there are other possibilities. They might still be out there somewhere. Hmm. So let's just hope that they are.
Interestingly, your first book, The World Up Close, you wrote the year that the Gardner Museum heist took place.
That's right. Yeah, yeah. Yeah.
Were you inspired by that then? Or did this something develop
over
time?
No, it's completely different. No, I was inspired by the Isabel Stewart Gardner Museum because it's such a beautiful museum.
It actually is.
Yeah. And there was something that really... really struck me about that is that Isabella Stewart Gardner, it was her house.
That's right.
And she decorated. Yeah. She had a lot of money. Mm-hmm. She decorated. But she did something really wonderful. She just opened her house to the public. Mm-hmm. And she could have bought a yacht. She could have done what a lot of rich people mm-hmm. do today, which was spend money on herself.
Right.
But she opened it, and it was free. Mm-hmm. She opened it to the public,
right.
and gave us this wonderful space to use. And I was really inspired by that. And in fact, the character in my book wants to do something similar. He's inspired by her act of generosity, and he wants to open a museum himself,
yeah.
And because he's a classical scholar, he wants to open it dedicated to Pythagoras,
yeah.
who he thinks is the greatest philosopher and teacher.
How much does the character, I think it's Paris is his name,
yeah,
in the book,
yeah.
How much does he reflect you, Kameel?
Well, there's obviously some little connection there. Oh, by the way, he falls in love with a woman at the museum. So her name is Helen. So it's Helen Paris.
There we go. Okay, very good. Yeah. So you have an adventurous spirit to you too.
Yes, that's right. So it's out of that tragedy, that great tragedy of the heist, and as I say, it might end badly. I tried to make something that was positive out mm-hmm. of it, mm-hmm. which was a story that we can use.
Tell me about the cover art. Who's the woman on the cover?
Oh, it's just somebody who designed the woman. I thought it was a little bit intriguing.
Very much so, yeah. It's a bit of aura and mystery to it.
Yes,
sure.
That's right.
Are there other heist books in your future?
Yes, this is a series, the beginning of a series. So all I've published so far was nonfiction books, mm-hmm. and now I'm beginning a series. This is it's called A Cozy Mystery because it's fun and it's easy.
Yeah.
And there are no murders and violence and things like that. And there's going to be another one about classical music coming up soon, and another one after that. So it's a group of three based in Boston. So there's a lot of Boston in here, you know.
Yes, yeah.
The Public Garden, the Back Bay, the whole world, art world.
At your talk here at the library, at the end of it, will folks know how you at least solved the crime?
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
So they don't have to read the book beforehand.
No. But I mean, there is a mystery, so I'm not gonna spoil it
right.
At the end. But yeah, the people will know how.
Okay. Very good.
In fact, it's solved. It's solved in the first chapter.
Oh, it is.
The person finds the art in the first chapter, and then he uses his knowledge of classicism mm-hmm. to discover who did it.
Interesting.
Yeah.
Which I found curious that he brings the work back to the scene of the crime. That was very interesting. He finds it in New Mexico and brings it back to Boston.
He has to bring it back in order to get the reward.
Money, yeah.
He uses the reward money and his ability. He was, by the way, he was an art forger. He went to jail because he forged some classical art. And he did it as a lark. He made it, he didn't do it for money.
Right.
But Anyway.
Okay, and as I recall, that was part of the original investigation too, was they had an art forger as a suspect at least.
Yes, that's right, yeah. That's right. There were all kinds of theories mm-hmm. about who did it. Mm-hmm. I mean, it was the Corsican mob, it was
right.
Canada, it was the IRA, it was, they went, the FBI went to Tokyo, yep. they went to Mexico, it was all over the place yep. About who did it. They had thousands and thousands of tips. And recently, earlier this year, when they released this video showing the day before where someone had come in, it
yes.
took them 25 years to before they viewed that video. When they released that video, they had another hundreds of tips, dozens of mm-hmm. tips mm-hmm. about who this person is. But probably that person wasn't involved in the theft.
Mm, interesting.
So I mean, so you have now most. Art thefts involve an inside connection.
Right.
So they've always been looking at yeah. that. And then you have all these different crime gangs, and these crime gangs were warring with one another. And so it's a very intriguing story.
Yeah.
Plus the reward money, $5 million. Anybody who could find the art, there's $5 million waiting for them.
Still, it's still being offered to this day. Yeah.
That's right. That's right. That's right.
And yeah. at the museum, actually, itself, the blank frames are still on the wall where those original works sat.
That's right, yeah.
They've made that part of the exhibit now.
That's right. Yeah. So Isabella Stewart Gardner said that the building should remain as it is,
mm-hmm.
and which is a lot different than, for example, at the Museum of Fine Arts, where the art changes all the time.
Right.
I'm a docent at the Museum of Science in Boston,
oh.
and we have 50,000 members. We have to change the exhibits all the time.
Sure.
And in fact, at the MFA right now, there is a Dutch Masters exhibit, and the two most expensive paintings that were robbed on 1990 were a Vermeer and a Rembrandt. So
Dutch
yeah,
artists,
and, there, and it was such a loss because that Rembrandt, it's really beautiful. It's Storm Over the Sea of Galilee, Jesus and the Disciples,
mm.
and it's the only seascape that Rembrandt painted. And the Vermeer, I think there are only 34 Vermeers that exist, and they're both really beautiful. The way Vermeer uses light and they're. When you're next to an object like that that's real and beautiful, it kind of, there's some feeling in your chest that goes out to them.
Mm. It's why yeah. it's a masterpiece, right?
Yeah, that's yeah. right. Yeah, yeah, why it's a masterpiece.
In researching this work, Kameel, do you think you know who committed the crime?
There are these names that come up
yeah.
Again and again, so it might be one of those people
okay.
that committed the crime.
Okay. It might be just an unsolved mystery.
It might remain an unsolved mystery, yeah.
Well, we look forward to your presentation again. It's Tuesday, December 8th from 7 to 8:30 p.m., and thank you for coming in to share a little bit with us today.
Oh, it's so nice to be here with you and to talk about this. And I look forward to being here in the library. I just live down the street, by the way, yes.
Very good.
And I come to the library and research one of the most beautiful buildings in the area.
It certainly is, yeah.
Yeah.
So it'll be familiar to you then.
Yeah, thank you.
If you'd like more information about this or any of the programs at the library, just visit their website, thomascranelibrary.org.